Yeah, shall we start, ma'am? Yeah, shall we start, ma'am? Just I'll briefly introduce you yourself, ma'am. Just hold on.
Yes.
Good afternoon to one and all. Welcome back to the session number 8. So this session is on towards Fit India Movement. The prescribed process is to have certain sessions related to health or your some kind of stress management and so on and so forth. So session is basically now on towards how do you manage the stress at your workplace or at various other places. So for this, we have today with us Ma'am Dr. G. Padmaja. Let me introduce her. Ma'am, Dr. G. Padmaja has a qualifications of MA, MPhil, PhD in psychology from Usmani University and UGC NET qualified. So her areas of interest are health psychology, counseling, psycho-oncology, geriatric health, and health of women. She is in innovative teaching. She has prepared the e-learning materials, and the materials are available on the IFLU audio-visual lessons, as well as on the Swayam platform too. Ma'am has got certain materials, which she worked as a principal investigator. Through the MOOC courses, there's a lot of materials are there. So Swayam courses for BA Psychology, MOOCs program from Usmani University, so various others. So ma'am is extensively contributed a lot in this particular field. So her research projects, which are completed so far, are effect of neurofeedback as therapeutic intervention for students with problems in attention and concentration. Another project is on prevalence of depression in patients reporting for cardiac, gastrointestinal, pulmonary, and skin problems. So currently she is investigating on the project sanctioned by ICSSR IMPRESS scheme on women, aging, and health, basically a framework for action and policy formulations. She is also a principal investigator for the project sanctioned under Institute of Eminence, University of Hyderabad, titled Healthcare Needs and Practices in Indian Men and Women with Reproductive System Cancer. So another project is on the multidimensional support for the aging population with assistive technologies. So far, ma'am, under the guidance of ma'am, 2 PhDs were awarded, and currently 3 ongoing projects have been carrying on. So her publications, she has published one book as a co-editor for trauma and pain, biopsychological social perspectives. Basically, it is a Global Vision Publishing House, New Delhi. And she has various research articles published in various journals of Indian Journal of Psychiatry, Psychosocial Interventions for Health and Well-being, Springer's, and so on and so forth. So enormous publications are there. Just briefly given you a couple of things. And awards, with respect to awards, she has attained the Certificate of Appreciation from Commissioner of College Education, AP, and a second best paper award in conference, second Indian Cancer Congress in the November 25, 2017, and she is a reviewer for various international and national journals, and she does an extensive activities related to counseling at Center for Health Psychology, University of Hyderabad, at our university center, and counseling and awareness programs through media. Of course, she's a columnist in Unity newspaper, a counseling and awareness program in the ETV to Saki program, resource person for helplines and panel discussions in several channels. She's been invited lectures for, she has done training programs on the soft skills, resource development programs in more than 25 organizations. And she is a member of Board of Studies, Department of Psychology, Usmani University, member of Board of Studies, Clinical Psychology. So as far as the academic ratings, the textbooks, chapters, the various multiple publications are there. So this is a brief biodata about ma'am. So may I request ma'am to take over the session, ma'am?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Narendra. That was a very nice introduction, a warm introduction from you. Thank you. Can I share the screen? I would like to present a PowerPoint presentation. So can I share the screen?
Yes, madam, you can do.
Is the screen visible?
Yes, madam. Yes, madam.
So, warm welcome to everyone, all the participants. Well, this is a computer science related workshop, and here is the psychologist talking to you, and that too about stress management. Yeah, what you people work with a lot of virtual reality converted into the real reality, or real reality converted into the virtual reality. But here we are, who are always into the reality of life. We psychologists talk about behavior, bother about behavior, help with behavior patterns, and not just the overt behavior, but also, you know, the cognitive, cognitive and affective processes, we call them, you know, your thoughts, your higher order thinking, your emotions, as well as your will, the motivation and the reinforcement factors. So we talk about all these things, and definitely it is our computer science and psychology are very closely related, especially when it comes to information processing and, you know, the inputs that the cognitive inputs that we commonly share, the cognitive arena that we commonly share, both psychologists as well as information technology commonly shares. Well, now when it comes to stress, I would exactly talk about all these cognitive, cognitive, affective processes which I have been talking about. While stress manifests itself, it shows itself, the output is in various ways. What is the processing which goes on within is what we are going to look at today, and what can we do in order to change that. You know, if I have to use your terminology, if there is a bug, how to debug, if there is a problem, how to deal with it. So your problem solving approach, which you very commonly use, how it can be helpful over here, and what are the various strategies that you can use. I'm given a time of about, I guess, one hour and 15 minutes from now. So I'll try to cover as much as I can within this time limit. And I hope I don't overshoot from the time which is allotted to me. And there will be some scope for discussion as well, if I can finish it within 1 hour. Let's see, let's try. If time permits me, maybe I can demonstrate a small relaxation exercise as well to you, if time permits me, no promises made. So, well, we talk about stress. Who doesn't talk about stress? Into every life, we all want some gain, some blessing. But what if there is a flood? This is precisely where we get into trouble. We all want that tiny, those tiny drops of, you know, relaxing rain in our, yes, we don't mind having a little bit of stress. We don't mind a little bit of pressure. We don't mind a little bit of tension. But what if we are flooded with these tensions, stresses, these pressures, overwhelming? So much so that we somewhere wither up. We get into troubles, and we show manifestation of stress in many ways. Is there any life without stress? One question that I would like to ask. Is there a life without stress? Any lucky one among you who doesn't feel stressed yet? Any lucky person, fortunate not to have or feel any stress at all, have never experienced stress at all in your life? You may unmute yourself and answer me if there is any fortunate person over here in this group. Am I audible? Am I audible? Okay, I guess not really anyone who I have been fortunate to share discussion with who said absolutely no stress, madam. There may be people who say, yeah, there are stresses, but I can deal with it. There are some people who say, no, ma'am, I block myself from stresses. I somehow see to it that I don't feel stressed up. They are there, stressors are there, but then I try my best not to get stressed up. And there are some people, yeah, stress is there, I enjoy it sometimes. And there are people who say, oh ma'am, I run away from stress. So, or I transfer my stress to others. There are several responses that I keep getting when I ask people about whether they are stressed at all. But let me also tell you, yes, stress is inevitable. You ask your two-year-old child or two-year-old cousin or cousin's child or anyone who is around you, if at all they have language enough to express their stress, they would tell you. If at all they have the capacity to express that they are stressed, they will tell you. Ask a person who is, you know, on the platform waiting for the call from up there, from Almighty up there, waiting, desperately waiting to get a call. You know, person who is in the last stages, even such a person would talk about stress. Who doesn't talk about stress? Who does not experience stress? There isn't any person who, if language can permit them and if expression can permit them to talk about stress, I don't think there is anyone, not at large, who can really say that there is no stress at all. Everyone experiences stress in some way or the other. How a child experiences stress? A child experiences stress because they have to, it's that maya that we pull them into, isn't it? Don't we pull them into this external world, waking up and pushing them to learn those standing lines and sleeping lines and slanting lines? At 2 itself, we are not even allowing them till 5, not 4 for that matter. We are starting at 2. Otherwise, we feel that our children are lagging behind. There is stress, which they may. That is the reason why many children turn out to be cranky. Their stress is not expressed in terms of verbal language, which is limited for them. Their verbal skills are limited. So what do? They can turn cranky. They throw tantrums. They create a lot of stress to the parents. They don't allow parents to function. They show their manifestation is in many ways. They may show psychophysiological problems. So many, many, many ways of expressing our stress, we will talk about that briefly. So what happens when there is stress? Overwhelming stress. I'm not talking about the basic level. You don't even feel stressed up. I don't call it stress. I'm talking about a stress where you experience that. And what happens when you are under stress? Your heart beats faster. You breathe faster. There is an adrenaline rush in you. Your muscles tighten up. Your blood moves from the center of the body so that there is a what is called fight or flight response, if I have to use our terminology. Either you run away from the stressful situation or you fight back. Even to run away, even for the flight, psychologically or physically, your blood has, the supply has to be enough. And if you have to fight also, the blood supply has to be, circulation has to be such. So blood moves from the center of your body over to your limbs, your pupils dilate. Stress, however, is a non-specific response of the body to any perceived demand. Any perceived demand, which is not an ordinary demand, but it becomes challenging to you. So the response to the events which are challenging and threatening, this is where I just said, not to any demand, but to the demands which are challenging, which are threatening, which may be risky, which may create a sense of insecurity in you somewhere, or a sense of, you know, a drive that you have to push yourself ahead to handle it or run away from it. So challenging and threatening events are what I'm talking about. It's both a state of physical arousal. You sweat, like for example, in the previous slides that I have explained, the physiological responses. In addition to that, there is a psychological response. You become very alert. All your energies are focused on dealing with it. All the others in your priority become, in your priority list become insignificant compared to this stressful event which is happening at this point in time. And very often, the threat or challenge is perceived by you as a threat or a challenge. It may not be threatening to somebody else, but to you it may be threatening. To the person, it depends upon individual interpretation based upon individual perception. So perceived by you, by an individual, as a threat or challenge, and in different cultures, it is expressed differently, depending upon your culture, culture of the family, culture of the society, culture of the community, culture of the country. From micro to macro level, there are several variations in this. So it's expressed differently by different people. So if I have to go into my technical definition of what is stress, it's an interference that disturbs a person's mental or physical well-being. Your well-being is what is affected over here. That's what we are bothered about. It disturbs your person, a person's psychological as well as physical well-being. And what is physiology has to, what does physiology have to do over here? Or physical well-being? You know, the release of chemicals called cortisol and epinephrine, or the adrenaline, it increases whatever we have talked in the previous slides. The heart rate, the metabolism, the breathing, the muscle tension, as well as the blood pressure, which are responsible for what are called fight or flight responses, which I have described a little while ago. It releases 1400 chemical reactions in our body, some continuing for hours after the stressor that caused it has passed. Now imagine a person having to face a stressful situation at a point in time and having these chemical reactions happening in our body, which are 1400 in number, and some of these, out of these 1400, may continue to have their impact even after the stressor has passed it, even for hours. And imagine somebody who has to face stress at a regular, as on a regular basis, continuously, consistently, for a long period of time. The persistent stress which does not leave you. So imagine a person who has to stay within that stressful pattern continuously. And imagine the reactions happening within. So what happens when there are continuous reactions physiologically and psychologically? So mental and physical condition which occurs when a person must adjust or adapt to the environment. How do you deal with the stress? You may have to adjust to the environment or adapt to the environment or bring the events into your control. So there may be a physical reaction over here with your autonomic nervous system being aroused, and a stressor, which is a condition or event which challenges or threatens the person, may continue for a long time. And the pressure mounts when a person must meet the urgent external demands and expectations consistently. The stressor may create a pressure in you, and this multiplicity of the pressures may create stressful reactions in you. So what is stress? It's your mind and body's response or a reaction. It can be a real threat. It can be an imaginary threat. It can be an event. It can be anything. It can be anything which causes this insecurity. The threat, event, or change are commonly called these threats or events or changes which have happened with relation to you at this point in time where you are experiencing distress. Those are called the stressors. They can be internal. Like I said, an event can be threatening if you perceive it to be threatening. It can be because of your thoughts, it can be because of your beliefs, it can be because of your attitudes. It can be a thought when a friend, when a colleague shouts at you in, let's say, a very hypothetical situation. Let's say a colleague shouts at you in front of your other colleagues. If according to your thought, he should not, there is something wrong with him, he's targeting me, hence he's shouting at me. If there is a thought, and if there is a belief that he is against me, and if there is an attitude that I cannot be shouted at and I have to throw it back to him, then your reaction may be different. And vice versa. If the other person thinks the same way about you, his reaction may be different too. It can be also, so these thoughts, beliefs, and attitudes, like I said, the cognitive, cognitive, affective processes, which are a part of us, are internal. Or it can be external, something which is beyond your control, like the loss of property or person or anything, prestige, anything. It can be a tragedy. It can be a super change, a superior change which you are not able to handle at that point. So what happens when this stress occurs? Most people find that too much or too little stress hinders their performance. Interesting? Yes. Too little stress, you feel bored, unmotivated, like when we don't have targets, and when they say, please finish it at your earliest. What is earliest for them? We don't know. So it is definitely not a priority to us, because they just left it open, saying that finish it at your earliest. But then it will be too much stress to us. And when there is too little stress, we feel bored, we feel unmotivated, we don't do the tasks at that point in time. Same is the case with too much stress, just as too little stress. Suppose they ask you to do a Herculean task within 1 hour. The target is 1 hour. You feel overwhelmed. You feel fearful, frozen. You don't understand what should be done, what can be done. However, there is what is called a moderate stress, which energizes you. You know that there is a target within 2 days or 2 weeks or whatever, and then you can think of ways of doing it. It probably you cannot do it alone, so you gather strength from social support, you make a team, or you seek the support from others, and you think about the task. You divide it into major and minor priorities and goals, and then you try to reach the major goal by dealing with the minor goals. That makes you more efficient. You are on task. You decide, you strategize upon how to move ahead with it. As a computer professional, you have a flowchart. You have steps. You program yourself to reach it. So this is where let's talk about some types of stress. Two types of stress to start. The first and foremost is what is called a eustress. Eustress is not Y-O-U-E. It's a eustress. It is a positive stress, which occurs when your level of stress is high enough to motivate you to move into action so that you get things accomplished. It's a positive stress. You want to do it. You want to prove yourself. You are motivated to do it. The cognitive aspect over here. However, life is not that simple. What happens? Very often, you experience what is called distress. It's a negative stress, which occurs when your level of stress is either too high or too low, and your body and your mind, all your mind, begin to respond negatively to this process. Now, let's talk about the physiological. First, the physiology, then we go to the psychology of stress. The physiological effects of stress. Day in and day out, many of us experience this, hence the priority to physiological effects of stress. Too much stress inhibits your digestion, growth, tissue repair, response of your immune system, and as well as inflammatory systems. I am talking on the basis of certain studies that people, even the common cold that we talk about, is not so very common. There is much more to it when we say common. It's very common in people who have high stress. People with high level of stress are twice as likely to develop colds than those with low stress. Please refer to the first point which I have mentioned. It affects your response of immune system. 70 to 80% of the doctor visits, according to the physiologist, the physician reports, are stress-related illnesses. How many of us, for that matter, have these problems? High blood pressure by 40, headaches, common even to a child, backaches, indigestion, ulcers, diarrhea, fatigue, insomnia, physical weakness. Is there any system in your whole body which does not get affected by stress? However, it depends upon your vulnerable zone. Each of us, we have a particular zone in the body which may be vulnerable. Let's take, for example, the ulcers. When you work overtime, you don't think about your food. It's a simple logic. When you are stressed up, when there is a target, by tonight you have to submit something, or by tomorrow morning you have to submit something, you don't have enough information, you are worked up, you are stressed up. Hence, what do? You don't let anyone talk to you. You shout at your family members, you shout at your colleagues, or if you are not a person who shouts at others, you shout at yourself and you shut yourself in a room, and then you may have several number of coffees or teas or whatever. Or if you are a foodie, you overeat, or you may forget about food altogether. You don't have your lunch, you have minimum breakfast or minimum lunch, which may not be sufficient to you, but you kind of forget. Even if there are hunger pangs, your mind doesn't allow you, your thoughts don't allow you to pay attention to your physiological needs, except when they are very pressing. So even going to the washroom is minimized, or you go a number of times. your digestive system will ask for certain things, for food, you don't allow it to, or you suppress the hunger with the help of tea or coffee a number of times. And then by the end of the day, you might have had several coffee mugs on your table or tea mugs on your table adding up. And then at the end of the day, even at night, you realize that you have not reached the target yet. So your work timings are extended. Either you go home or you remain in your lab, you continue. You're with your laptop, you're with your computer. Again, some junk food or no food. If it is junk food, you don't care what the junk food is. It's not a choice over here. It's a need which has to be fulfilled. So some food which can satisfy your hunger, or more coffees, more teas. And sometimes you may have support till then, but late evening, you may not have as much support. Or you yourself decide that I don't need support and you have to work alone. You sit through night, 10 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, and you continue on and on. Morning 10 o'clock is your deadline. Somehow you have reached your deadline around 10 o'clock. That is when, once you click the button, go, send, then you are relaxed. And then you realize your body is aching. Your body is refusing to cooperate with you. You are feeling hungry, you are feeling angry, you are feeling stressed out. You are feeling, you, it's like, you know, you are angry with the whole world. What is this? What I'm doing? Imagine yourself doing this again and again. Won't your digestive system get affected? Won't the acids secreted in your digestive system, will they cooperate with you? Would your system get tuned to your, would have been a regular pattern? And then imagine yourself having to do this repeatedly again and again. And the next time you have a deadline and target, today you believe, you know, after you click the send button, you say, no, hereafter I'm going to be very careful. I'm not going to take this stress anymore. But next time you get a target, again the same behavior, again the same frustration, again the same conflicts. You get angry with yourself, you get angry with the world, you get angry with people who don't cooperate, or you perceive that they don't cooperate. At the end of it, what is happening? Repeatedly, you're targeting your digestive system. And let us say your digestive system is the vulnerable area of your body. What happens? Hyperacidity. And you gulp certain tablets. And repeatedly, after some time, you decide that, okay, chalo, let me have this and my acidity pill with me. And then let me finish. All the others don't change. But the only additional change that you brought about is having tablets with you. And after some time, what's going to happen to your digestive system? Some people report ulcers. Some people chronic hyperacidity. Same is the case with hypertension. Why is it that we see even, let me also talk about juvenile diabetes, juvenile hypertension and all, even children today are facing these problems. Obesity, what about obesity? Such a common word which is being used today, we hate it, but then that's there. Backaches, professionals, many professionals, headaches. No, not for women, please. Anyone, for that matter. Indigestion, ulcers, diarrhea, fatigue, insomnia. After a point in time, even if you want to sleep, you don't have work that day, you don't have a target that day, you want to sleep, hey, good day for me, sleep. And then you go, and then you don't feel sleepy. And you sit with your YouTube, your this little tiny little instrument which rules you, or your laptop, which you call relaxation. No sleep, physical weakness. All these are, so what are they? These are physiological symptoms. Now coming to the emotional effects of stress. Anger, hostility, irritability, anxiety, sadness. Depression is a big word that I'm using. It's a clinical term, which I wouldn't support. I wouldn't label people just like that with the term depression. But yes, probably some distress, powerlessness. All these are accompanying problems. Why, when, how, well, it's individually determined. It's customized. One person may have some of these or one of these. One person may not have any of these at all. It may be a different manifestation. But emotional effects are very likely to be there. It can be anger. It can be anger directed towards the self, or it can be anger directed towards the other, which turns into hostility. And irritability with your family members, with your colleagues, a person who is being otherwise peaceful and smiling, wouldn't no more appear that way. Your anxiety, oh my God, my targets. And anyone talks anything else, you're not entertaining that. No jokes or no fun, no relaxation would allow, you would allow, because you are anxious. You may be sad for self, for others, for your family members, for the colleagues, for the interactions that you don't have or may not have. You may feel powerless. You may feel helpless. All these may be accompanying emotional reactions. So in this context, let me go a little theoretical and tell you what happens when a person tries to adapt. I said adjustment to the stressful situation and adaptation to the stressful situation. At this point in time, let me just give a small pause and ask you if there are any questions before I go ahead. Are there any questions? Anyone would like to ask any questions? Any questions, please? If there are no questions, then I would like to move ahead.
Any participants, if you have any doubts, please do post it. Very much stress in education. Ma'am, there is a question on the chat box. Mm-hmm. There's very much stress in the education. Prakash, oh. Meena.
Okay, we'll talk about it. We'll talk about it towards the end.
Hope there are a couple of questions, ma'am. There are a couple of questions in the chat box. One more question is, how do we deal with pressure or stressful situations? Does it ever impact our work-life balance?
Yes, it does. So that's what we are proposing to talk about today, to the extent possible within the time available to us. Yes, we will talk about it, how to deal. More, sir? Any other questions?
Very much raise your hand. Participants can raise their hand if you have any questions, so that I will give you the permission to unmute yourself. No questions so far, madam.
Okay, no problem. Yeah, I've just checked the chat box. So these two are the questions which already have been communicated to us. So we will talk about, we will discuss these questions in detail towards the end. I hope the time comes. And some probably my interpretation, my explanation in the coming few slides may also offer some answers to you. So coming to the adaptation that I have been talking about.
I'm sorry to disturb you, madam. There is a question from one of the participants.
Yes. Yes, please.
Sir, you could mute unmute yourself, sir.
Madam.
Yes. Yes, please.
If the psychological effects are affecting on immune system, you said in one of the previous slides, how long the health will come back, or I mean, will be readaptable to the normal position? How long it will take the time back to its normal?
How long? How long is the question? That's the crux of the question. Well, how long is individually determined? How long is individually determined? Let me just talk about these adaptation syndrome. Then probably after that, we will deal with your questions. Okay? So I think some of the answers you're going to get in a short while. For various questions. May I move ahead? May I go ahead? And I'll come back to your question after this. May I move ahead?
Yes, madam. Please go ahead.
Okay. So when there is a stress, as I told you, we try to adjust to that stress. We try to adapt. So what happens is, this is how. You have asked me, you have talked about the immune system and the response of the immune system, any system for that matter. any physiological, psychological reaction can follow this pattern. When there is a stress, look at the normal level of resistance. You see the baseline over here? When there is a stressor, initially, there may be an alarm reaction. This alarm will help us to resist it. So it's like you are gathering all your energies of your body physiologically, psychologically, in order to resist that stressor. Let's say you see a threat at this point in time. So what do you do? You gather all your energies either to fight it or move away from it. Am I right? Fight or flight. That's what I said. So there is a resistance to that stressor, and you build up all your energy to resist that. And finally, when the situation crosses also, you continue that resistance for some time, and slowly that resistance droops down. And you go into a stage where you feel exhausted. Remember, you have gathered all your energy. You have collected all your energies and you have put them together in dealing with it. So now what happens? In a stress reaction, there are certain phases. Acute phase, reaction phase, repair phase, and reorientation. What happens in this acute phase? This acute phase may last minutes, hours, or even days. So this is where I told you fight or flight response. You gather all your energies. You prepare for some physical activity. Either you want to run away from the threatening situation or you fight with the threatening situation. And then what happens is your focus, which may have been distributed among many, many things so far, would now narrow itself down. And so what happens is you are just focused upon this stressor. Either you want to fight or you want to fly away from it. You want to run away from it. Either fight or flight. So your response, while preparing you for this response, your ability to think in several angles diminishes, and you bring yourself to narrowing your focus upon just the stressor. So there may be accompanied emotional reactions at this point in time, like, for example, disbelief, consternation, fear, grief. It can be any of these this emotional reactions. And then this is about the affective aspect of it. So the cognitive aspect of it is narrowing of focus, and affective aspect of it can be your accompanying emotional reactions. And when it comes to behavior manifestation, you show irritability, anger, which may affect your communication. Panic is rare. Not everyone panics, or not in all situations we panic. But it may be present, and it may require immediate attention also. Some people may go into that panic situation where you may have to help them to come out of that panic. Then comes the reaction phase, which lasts 1 to 6 weeks. Sometimes there may be delayed reactions. Whatever has been previously repressed, even without your repression, is pushing certain thoughts or perceptions or whatever conflicts into deep seats of your unconscious, even without your knowledge. Even without your knowledge, they go into your unconscious. That is repression. Or denied feelings. You didn't want to think that way. Those such feelings which have been otherwise repressed or denied, now they may surface. Now they may come to the surface, and you may experience these feelings. And it may be overwhelming, bringing feelings of powerlessness. Why did I have to face this stress? Why did I have to face this stress? Why me? Such questions may come. Then comes the reaction phase. Typical reactions may be there, especially if it is traumatic. I'm talking in terms of stressor, which may be very traumatic. You don't even want to go back to that event, that place where it occurred, or the memories of that. There may be, and if it is traumatic, again, I'm using the word trauma, please, which is a higher end word. There may be dreams or nightmares. There may be anxiety. There may be restlessness. There may be sleeplessness. There may be muscular tension, tremors, and exaggerated startle response at the remembrance, at the memory of that stressor, which has created trauma in you. And then there may be increased irritability and isolation. There may be depression, and there may be disturbance. All these extreme reactions which I'm talking about are when the stressor creates such a trauma in you that this happens. And under trauma, these acute phase and all these phases happen, which I have listed happen. So repair phase, of course, it lasts 1 to 6 months, and reactions are less intense and not so overwhelming. slowly the feelings of hurt continue, but you can manage, you know, you may not forget, but you tend to forgive slowly, and renewed interest in everyday life may be there, and you try to make plans for future. That's when you enter the reorientation phase. After the distressing event passes or it is continuing, heightened stress reactions are substantially reduced. Grief reaction may not be resolved but is accepted. Most reactions will diminish gradually, and assessing ongoing needs becomes important. Now, why did I talk about it? We are in a special phase, the whole world in a special phase, in an unanticipated, unprecedented special phase. We have been talking to certain people who have undergone this, who have actually themselves experienced COVID-19, or who might have had person or persons in the family or near and dear, friends, relatives, or whatever, who might have undergone corona. So this corona, the very term corona, after a point in time, we have been, it's a phase that we have been going through for the past more than 1 year, isn't it? Starting off in December 2019, that time we were not very scared. We were only thinking about somebody else getting it. Slowly in January, there was a little fear. In February, more fear. In March, we thought, okay, my God, even India, we have been, we are at risk as well. And then by April, by March 23rd or 21st or whatever, everything was very clear to us, and we went into that lockdown phase as well. And from then on, that fear which it has created, the stress that corona has created, has been unprecedented. Not only from a physiological point of view, from a psychological point of view. There were several helplines, and some of us psychologists have been a part of more than one helplines, where we have to talk to people who have been affected. There was one mother who was an employed person. Her husband has been affected. She had the he was employed somewhere, and he had to fly down from one particular place to Hyderabad, and he got held up over here, and then she had to deal with the trauma of having a COVID patient at home, and she had two senior citizens at home. She had young children at home, and she had to do everything all alone. And she had to work from home. She had to take care of this COVID patient in a small, tiny home that I have, where my husband is usually not here. Unfortunately, something which I had to be happy about and unhappy about, he had to come here. And he, in the process, he is affected. And how to handle it. And these two senior citizens at home and children at home, and myself being vulnerable, how am I going to handle this? At the same time, husband being with her is something which she has to be happy about. But should she be happy? Should she be unhappy? So several such stresses that she had to face, fears, helplessness, hopelessness, powerlessness. And there was a mother whose child got affected. And then she had to face with the trauma. She had to take care of the child, but at the same time, it's her own child that she should be scared to in order to go there. Stressed out. So several such instances and fears that you, if you talk to your own person, someone who comes from outside, you may be affected. It's like, you know, there was a physical distance which was creating a lot of psychological distance. Several problems during those first 6 months. Slowly people got used to, of course, thanks to scientific advances, thanks to the technology, thanks to the authentic messages, people slowly started, you know, that adaptation to the psychological concept of, yes, we have to face it. We have to face it. So that is where some change was brought. But then meanwhile, the stress. Can some trauma affect the whole world? Yes, it did. It did. Trauma can be individual. One person, two people, 10 people. But here is a trauma which the whole world had to face. And the whole world was under severe stress. And the whole world together also tried to deal with it. Now think about whatever I have talked about. Several cases. Look at the trauma of a pandemic creating such an overload of stress, which turned out to be traumatic, and we had to deal with it. Now comes a big question. Why doesn't everyone react to stressors the same way? One of our colleagues, one of our friends has asked, if it creates an effect upon the immune system, how long does it take? This is where I talk about individual differences. Stressors may not directly create their impact upon immune system for every person, may not create an impact upon any other system, I mean like circulatory system or digestive system or whatsoever on every person. Even if they do create their impact, the impact may not be the same in every person. Every person may not have the same vulnerable zone in the body. Every person may not have the same cognitive or cognitive or affective responses to stress as another person. I hope all these individual differences are understood. If that is the case, how long a person may have the effect, or how strong a person may have the effect, how intense the reaction can be, will vary. It is individually determined. Like the question which I have put over here. Why doesn't everyone react to stressors the same way? Let's go back to the same example, a very simple example which I have given some time ago today. I said, one of your colleagues has shouted at you in front of other colleagues. Let's say five of you are there and five of you had the same reaction. One of your colleagues has come and shouted at five of you. And the shouting has not been normal. It has been, you know, overwhelming. It's been heightened. You know, it was very, very personally oriented as well to all of you. So do all the five of you react the same way? One person may say, for example, if you ask your students the same question, one student may say, suppose you have shouted at your students, you go into your class and you shouted at your students, left and right, you have given them. So one of your students may think, for example, what's wrong with this madam today or sir today? Did she or he have a fight with the spouse? And one of them may think, boss must have shouted and hence this teacher is shouting. One person may think, why is teacher shouting at me? This never happened. Was it wrong with me? And because he didn't want to shout at me, he's shouting at everyone. One person may think, there must be something wrong today with us. All of us must have collectively contributed to some irritability which he or she is feeling. So this way, each of us has a separate reaction. There may be one student who may even start crying. There may be one student who may throw back answers at you rebelliously. One student who may just walk out of the room. One student who may just stand up and say, why are you shouting at me, sir? I think you are targeting me and not others. You are only trying to make it very general. So there may be reaction patterns which may be different. There may be reaction patterns where one student may just say and say, sorry on behalf of everyone, sir. Can you please tell us what can be done? There may be one person who may try to pacify you. Yes, sir, you are right, sir. We will all try to do whatever we have to. One person may say, sir, I think you are shouting at us for no reason. Can you please calm down? It may be different. Reactions may be different. This depends upon certain mediators. Like your cognitive appraisal, how we perceive the stressful situation, how we perceive the stressful situation, I repeat, how we interpret the stressful situation and how we accept it, our perception, our thoughts related to it, and our beliefs related to it. Like for example, when someone is shouting, if your thought is this person wants to tell me that I'm good for nothing, looks like I'm good for nothing. Let's say there is a negative thought associated with it. Then your belief is, I should not be shouted at. How can he shout at me? How can he determine whether I'm good for nothing or useful? So there may be, it's a cognitive appraisal that you are thinking about over here. It's how you perceive and interpret it and analyze it at that point in time. So all your cognitive processes which come into the appraisal system out there, and then the predictability of stressors. How is it going to be if I work with this particular teacher? If this teacher teaches me, how is it going to be? How stressful is it going to be? Then your perception of control. When we talk about control, we talk about what is called locus of control. Is your control internally determined or is it externally determined? Are your control mechanisms driven by you, or you are driven by somebody else or something else? And what are the type of coping resources that you have? Do you focus upon the problem, or do you focus upon the emotion? What is it that you use in order to cope with the situation? How much of social support can you gather? External support can you gather? All these things are going to determine. Thus, as I said, again, I go back to the question which is asked. When any particular system of the body is being affected by the process of stress, what happens? There are potential stressors which determine the stress mediators, or stress mediators which determine to the individual that, look, this is stressful. This is, you are feeling stressed out at this point in time. Like, for example, life change. Having to move from one house to the other may be stressful to an individual. Having to move from one house to the other may be pleasant to another individual. For a child, for example, for your child, you think a particular school is not good and you move your child from one school to the other. Let's say you do it in a span of 2-3 years, maybe 2-3 times. Then, in some children, that creates a lot of stress. It is a life change for them. It's a transition which may create a lot of stress in them, because by the time they create some friendship group and peer group which they feel close to, they're moving from there to another. By the time they get attached to that particular school and system and the teachers out there, they're moving from that school to another. In several cases that I have handled as a counseling psychologist, I did come across where the parents thought this school is no good, and then they kept changing. It may be a young child, it may be a grown-up child. Whatever it is, change may bring certain stress to some people. Some people may be affected. Remember, I'm telling you some people, not all. It may not be common to everyone. That's why life changes may, and the strains associated strains may be stressful to some people based upon the mediators which I have listed out over here, which I have already talked about. These mediators. So life change may create, based upon the cognitive appraisal, predictability, control, coping resources, and social support, some stress to some people, to some children, to some grown-ups, whereas it may not be. Imagine your own parents. When you ask them to move from one home to another, they would be reluctant. You ask them to come from their village to your place, they may not be very happy. They may only come and stay there for some time, and they may want to go back to their place that they have been conditioned to all these years. Your grandparents, for example. Your own children moving from one school to another, moving from one home to another. So life changes and strains, catastrophic events, daily hassles, chronic stressors, all these are potential stressors. But based upon your cognitive appraisal, predictability, control, coping resources, and methods, as well as social support, you have the stress response. For some people who use a very positive cognitive appraisal, which is very balanced and not highly based on emotions, the same life change may not be stressful. They may not have any stress response at all. But for some people whose cognitive appraisal or all these emotional aspects of it and all determine the stress, there may be some physical stress response in terms of psychophysiological problems, chronic health problems. Or there may be psychological problems with relation to emotional, interpersonal, cognitive, behavioral problems. And individual differences in the personality of the individual may also be responsible in stress reactions. Like, for example, very often we talk about disease-prone personalities and disease-resistant personalities. Here is where the immune system response once again comes into the picture, sir. If it is disease-prone personality, means it's not that you are born with a disease. You develop that very often. Heredity may contribute to some extent, but that personality that we determine, that we develop, that may be responsible. That is, if I go back to these stress mediators, let us say our stress mediators are such that we allow ourselves, we fall into that stress response category, either physical or psychological, that is when the disease-prone personality comes into picture. Whereas there may be some people whose cognitive appraisal may be very realistic and does not allow them to get into the stress responses often. Such are disease-resistant personalities. So also studies show that women follow, even when it comes to coping with the stress, while women follow what is called tend and befriend style, that is, they show their tenderness and they try to make friends with others, and they try to deal with the stress with tend and befriend style, whereas some of the men go into fight or flight pattern. Well, this is what some studies say. There are always studies which support them and which refute them. And there is a focus on research in recent times upon the personality and health as well. Now, this brings us to coping with stress. Coping is a way to prevent, delay, avoid, or manage stress. This is where our stress management comes into picture. Coping mechanism can be in many ways. You can cope with stress in many ways. One is change the source of stress. Don't allow that source of stress to create stress in you at all. Change it. Change the view of the situation. There is a saying, there is a realized soul who said in Telugu, I don't know how many of you understand Telugu, Srishti Maradu Drishti Marchipo. That is, change your perception. The world doesn't change. Change your perception. Change your perspective towards the world. So changing the view of the situation. The situation may not change, but our perception of the situation and our interpretation of the situation can be molded according to our adaptation. Tolerating the stressor until it passes or becomes less troublesome. Like, you know, keeping, just tolerating with it so that that does not have its intensity anymore. It may sound very unrealistic, but sometimes, for some people, it has been useful. Especially when the situation out there, externally determined, is out of your control. Then for some people, what happens is there may be an emotional numbness or extreme agitation. Two opposite poles. For some people, they become frozen when there is a stressful situation. They cannot think, they cannot do anything about it. And for some people, there may be an extreme agitation bordering on the level of panic. In either this or this, there is an immediate attention that we have to pay. And possibly, you may have to refer them for professional care at that point. And also, you have to inform to the person, like, for example, professional advice that you have to take. You may have to refer them to a counseling psychologist or a psychotherapist, a clinical psychologist, or sometimes, you know, psychiatric help may also be needed. You have to tell the person that this is what you're going to do. And the person may think that by referring to somebody, you are branding them as bad or whatever. You have to explain to them. You have to inform to them, not only inform, but also make them understand why you have to refer. So now comes the stress reduction. Like, for example, you may concentrate on choosing a new behavior. You may focus on changing a new behavior. This is one of the stress management techniques that we talk about. Like, for example, when there is an extreme stressor, detach yourself from that external stressor so that you can have a different kind of appraisal of the situation. The more emotionally you attach yourself to that stressor, this person is shouting at me, this person is troubling me, this situation is troubling me. The more you perceive the stressor, the more you may psychologically put yourself down. So what do? Try to separate, try to detach yourself. And then you may look at the whole situation from a totally different angle. When there is a financial stress, many people keep asking me, ma'am, you're talking so much, but financial stress is something which is beyond our reach, beyond our control. This is where the proactive appraisal, anticipating the unanticipated, may have to be brought into picture. So balancing and organizing the financial picture. Then coming to somebody asked me about the work-life balance. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Yes. Work-life balance may be disturbed over here. So what do? When there is a stressor and that stressor is inevitable, you cannot avoid it, you have to face it. What do? Delegate. Divide the situation into parts. Prioritize what you have to do, what you can do. What you cannot do, just look for what anyone else can do. This is where social support comes into the picture. Probably you can delegate a part, if not the whole, a part or some parts of whatever the strategies are in order to deal with the situation among yourselves, maybe your family, maybe your friends, maybe your colleagues, maybe your near and dear, maybe people important to you. Delegate certain of them to the others, or delegate certain of whatever the problems are to the timeline. Some may be dealt with now, but some may be dealt with later. And when you have to be, when you know that situation is going to be stressful and you are pushed into that situation and you don't want to enter that situation, you don't want to, then be assertive. Be assertive to the extent, to the limits possible. When you have to say no, try to understand your boundaries and say no at least to certain situations where you know you cannot do it, where you cannot handle it. Then comes the self-care aspect of it. As a health psychologist, I should also talk not only from a psychological, psychosocial perspective, but also from your physiological perspective, where you have a physical perspective, where you can take care of yourself, like for example, exercise, which causes relaxation. Exercise not only causes a lot of ventilation of your energy, but also a lot of relaxation. Depends upon what exercise you feel is comfortable to you. Relax. Relax using various methods. Like for example, we Indians, we relax using our own indigenous methods, meditation. Meditation need not be mantra based already. Meditation can be physical, physiological, psychological. It can be in terms of, you know, your meditation can be in terms of your closing your eyes and, you know, chanting a mantra or chanting or taking a deep breath. Or it can be just going into an imaginary visual world, which relaxes you, you know, thinking about good things of life, good things happening to you. When there is an imbalance, thinking about how balanced life has been, counting your blessings, if I have to say so, or imagining things which can relax you, which can relax you, like, for example, playing with your children or talking to your favorite people or going out on a visual trip to a hill station or whatever. Guided imagery. We use a technique called guided imagery. If time permits me, I can demonstrate, but I don't know if time would permit me. There are certain relaxation techniques that we teach. Meditation, exercise. For some people, relaxation can be just going out for a stroll with near and dear, with friends or family members or with spouse or with children, playing with children. For some people, music can be relaxing. For some people, painting and art, any form of art can be relaxing. For some people, talking to the friends can be relaxing. Breathe deeply. Breath is, it helps a lot. Well, we all know the typical theory of oxygen supply and you know, the alpha state and all those things. We also know that breathing, when you focus upon the breathing deeply, for some people, it can be just a deep breath to fill your lungs. For some people, it can be an abdominal breathing. It can be a deep breath, which can relax them when systematically done. Of course, you have to be trained in that. Then for some people, it may be uplifting music. Having good time with friends, being able to laugh, being able to, this is called cognitive distraction. When there is some stressor, it's not that you are going to run away from the stressor. While you are doing things which are necessary to deal with that stressor, also trying to relax yourself by sharing some good moments with your near and dear, sharing with people, social support, and caring for people who are in stress. Share and care is a great strategy. Then, choose your thoughts also involves being able to visualize the problems. This is something which can be taught also under careful professional training. What we usually do is, you have a problem. Problem is something which cannot be totally eliminated. So what do? You visualize the problems, you visualize the troubles, and you shrink them to a manageable size by visualizing what all can be done to deal with the problem. Some of the, especially we in this process, we come up with brainstorming. Several ideas, let's say you brainstorm and you come up with 50 ideas. 50 ideas out of 50 ideas, 25 may be just not very practical or cannot be applied. They may be great, some of them, but they cannot be applied. So we, out of the remaining 25, what is feasible, what is applicable? And when you apply strategy number one, how is this problem which I have visualized, how is it going to be dealt with? And what will be the outcome? Problem strategy two, strategy three. So it's like you visualize all these problems and you try to mentally associate each of these strategies that you think of which with this problem, and probably a combination of some of the strategies or one or two strategies may be helpful to you. You may apply one particular strategy if it fails, that world doesn't end with that. There are always solutions, alternate solutions. So what is the next alternative? What is plan A? What is plan B? What is plan C? What is plan Z? There are several plans which may be used useful. It's just that you're not able to perceive them because you're being stressed out. So it is what is called cognitive reappraisal of the situation, the problem, and also the solution. And challenge the pessimistic beliefs which say you cannot do it, you will not be able to do it, you will not be able to be helpful to yourself, you are useless, you are worthless, you are good for nothing. Challenge those beliefs. Like I said, when I said reappraisal of self as well. How many problems in my life I might have dealt with? Some of the problems I may not have dealt with positively, so what? That does not mean I haven't dealt with other problems. Out of 100 problems, 10 I may not have been able to handle. But 90 I might have handled. 50 I may not have handled. But 50 I was able to handle. So challenge those pessimistic negative beliefs which say that you cannot do it, you will not be able to do it. Focus on the positive. All of us are born with strengths. No two people match exactly in their strengths. If A has one particular strength, B may have another strength. Just because A has one particular strength and B has something else, that does not mean B is strengthless. B has his or her own strengths as well. So balance your strengths. Try to maximize your strengths. Realize basically for which you have to identify your strengths. Nobody is going to tell us. Nobody is going to come down from earth and heaven, from heavens to the earth and tell us, look, you have these strengths. No counselor will tell you what your strengths are. Counselors will make you realize your own strengths. We counseling psychologists, we make you realize your own strengths and maximize them. Do a SWOT analysis. I hope you've all heard about this SWOT. S is for strengths. W is for weaknesses. O is for opportunities. T is for threats. It's not just T which is there. There is S, W, and O. It's not just W which is there. There is S. There is O. So, utilize yourself so. Your strengths and your opportunities. Maximize your strengths. Understand your weaknesses. S is for strengths. Maximize your strengths. W is for weaknesses. Balance your weaknesses. Identify your weaknesses, but don't let them overpower you. There are strengths to balance them. Understand that there are opportunities. Look for opportunities. Identify the opportunities. Try to deal with threats. This is SWOT analysis. Your strengths, weaknesses, this, your SWOT analysis has to help you in maximizing your strengths, handling your weaknesses, identifying and utilizing your opportunities, and balancing the threats, dealing with the threats. That is where your SWOT analysis should be able to help you. For which you may have to focus upon your positives, which are there very much as a part of us. Find the opportunities. Every problem has opportunities. There is no problem which has a dead end. Every problem also has, it's just that we have to look for it. In every cloud, behind every cloud, there may be a silver lining. You have to wait. You have to search. You have to identify. Clouds don't remain forever. They come, but they wither off. So the problems may come, but how we deal with the problems is where we become successful. So look at your positives. Reappraise the situation. It may be overwhelming. Let that cool down, calm down. Then you can reappraise. Find the opportunities in the problem. Where there is a problem, there is a solution. Problems are there because there are solutions. Where there is a problem, there is a solution. If I face a problem, I will find a solution. All the others can only be facilitators, including the psychologist, that including me psychologist. Wherever the I is facing a problem, that I has a solution as well. Every person has the problems, but every person, who is there who doesn't have a problem? Every person has a problem, but every person has solutions within. It's just that we have to look for support everywhere, without and within. First, gather the support from within. Then you can gather the support from else, social support. Trust a positive outcome. And detach, not from people, but detach yourself from the problem in such a way that you can cognitively reappraise. Reframe the solutions. If your solution is, I'm good for nothing, I'm useless, I don't have, it's a blind alley, there is no way out, then reframe. What is the way out? What can I do in order to come out of it? And how can I come out? visualize success with safety. When you can visualize the problem and minimize it and look at solution, then you can also visualize the success with safety. Assume the best. Face the fear. When there is a fear, we run away from it. Face it. Because fear, once faced, will no longer remain the fear. It is fear because we are trying to avoid it. Face it. Problems are to be faced. You may not have the energy at the moment. Gather the energy. Take support, whatever is required, internal, external. Face it. Once you face it, fear no longer remains the fear. Identify your hurt. You may be hurt with certain things, that emotional aspect which I have talked about in my earlier slides. Identify that you are hurt. But then, when you forgive, your hurt is going to be balanced. You may not forget it. Identify. But how to unhurt yourself is also important. Forgive. I'm not asking you, many people may say, ma'am, it's easier said than done. How can we forget? I'm not asking you to forget. The more you try to forget, the more you'll remember. But forgive. You look at yourself as someone who is able to deal with it. And when you forgive the other person, you have raised yourself. Not only in self-esteem, but also in handling the problem. And yes, help. Psychosomatic disorders. Psychological factors contribute to actual illnesses or to damaging changes in bodily functioning. Hypochondriacs are those who complain about diseases which can be imaginary, but not always. Not everyone is a hypochondriac. So we do talk about certain psychosomatic diseases. So we usually advocate use of behavioral strategies to reduce stress and improve coping skills. There are several ways of coping. I think I need another session if I have to talk about several coping skills. As of now, I'm just going to talk about certain management strategies. Like, for example, progressive relaxation is what it has to be done professionally. And in case you want to do it on yourself, you have to be trained by professional psychologists in order to go for progressive relaxation. What is progressive relaxation? It produces a relaxation throughout your body. It is called progressive muscle relaxation. It's like, you know, it doesn't involve any mantra or whatever. You are made to either lie down or relax on it in an easy chair. And then progressively, every part of your body, every muscle of the body is tightened. And when it is, like, for example, look at my fist, which is tightened. As I'm tightening it, I'm building up the stress, isn't it? So along with this, I will also imagine building up stress inside. And I take a deep breath associated with it. And I hold it. And I understand the stress which I have built up. And then slowly, as I release my breath, I also release my muscle, which has been tensed up. And I also try to release my stress, which I have built up. So it is 3-in-1. Physically, you are trying to tighten, or the other side, you know, extremely stretching out your muscle, tightening your muscles or stretching out your muscles, two opposite directions. And every time when you tighten or when you relax systematically, you also take a deep breath and you have your thought. So it's cognitive, physical, physiological, all these are involved. So, and when you tighten the muscle, that you build up the stress, and when you relax the muscle, you also relax yourself in terms of, as you leave the breath, as you exhale, you also exhale the tension or the stress which you have built up inside. So that under the careful guidance of the professional psychologist, you tend to learn this. We start with the fist, we start with the muscles over here, and then we stretch, we extend it to the whole body, like, you know, your hand muscles, your shoulders, neck, face, all the muscles of the face, body, feet, till feet. And each will be in terms of first tightening and then stretching out. So every time there is the therapist or the counselor's guidance and instructions we keep giving, and we help you, facilitate you in taking the breath, holding it and releasing it as you relax the body. Did I make myself clear? Did you understand what I tried to tell you? This is called progressive muscle relaxation. It's called Jacobson's technique, which I have told you. Jacobson progressive muscle relaxation, JPMR it is called. Did you understand what I have tried to communicate to you? Relaxing the muscles of the body. You can even go for your yoga nidra. For example, our indigenous method. Then in addition to that, we use one more technique called, this is completely at a cognitive level, guided imagery. Here what we do is we find out what is most relaxing for them. Like for example, for some people, hillside and hill station visit. For some people, visiting a park or a garden. For some people, seaside. For some people, playing with their children. For some people, going into the forest, deep into the forest. All these can be very, very relaxing. So each to their own. So we customize our script according to the need of the client. So if a client feels, let's say, going into the garden is very relaxing. So we build a script accordingly. And then we ask them to relax on a couch or in an easy chair. And then we ask them to go visually, imagine visually as we give instructions. So step by step, we take them into a visual imagery. That is in their imagination, we take them into that most relaxing space that they have talked about. It's like, you know, they roam around there for some time. They relax thoroughly. They imagine everything, including all five senses. Like, for example, when I give you a visual imagery, saying that you have walked into the garden, I will ask you to imagine and feel the chirping of the birds, the rustling of the leaves, and then the breeze making the trees making sound as there is a cool breeze which is going around. Then I'll ask you to imagine the beautiful hues and colors of the flowers out there. Then I'll ask you to feel the touch of cool breeze on your body, gently touching your skin, you know, and then or the touch of the cool grass under your feet when as you walk on the grass, or the cool touch of water, or the warm touch of a flower or a bud, or a bird coming and sitting on your hand, outstretched hand, and then you feeling the rustle of its wings. You know, all these, and then I'll ask you to imagine tasting a drop of water or honey, and then feeling cool about it, feeling happy about it, feeling the taste of the water and the fragrance of the flowers, you walking into the near the flower beds, and then you having the fragrance of different flowers. All these are imagined as a part of your guided imagery. And when you go into that world of imagination, you thoroughly relax yourself. And then slowly we also bring you out of that world of imagination. This is called guided imagery. These are progressive muscle relaxation, guided imagery. These are some of the techniques that we use in our professional setup. Now, in addition to that, what can you do on your own? Avoiding upsetting thoughts. There is what is called the stress inoculation. That is using positive coping statements internally so that you control fear and anxiety. And these, in fact, these positive coping statements have to be designed so that you combat your stress. On the other hand, what happens is very often when we are stressed up, we make negative self statements. It's like self-critical thoughts. Such like, for example, when did I properly face it? I am good for nothing. I know I cannot do that. See, I got this situation again because I cannot handle it. That's why I'm feeling so stressed up. These are negative self-statements. And they create anxiety and they lower your performance. So what we help with over here is, what we advocate over here is, use positive coping statements. Yes, there were situations where I could, when you remember the situations where you could not handle the stress, remember also situations where you were able to handle it. Coping statements usually are designed by self, I mean by anyone, you, me, or anyone, in a reassuring way. And these are the self-enhancing statements so as to stop the negative self-statement. So we try to help in this stress inoculation where negative self-statements are replaced with positive self-statements. Of course, our indigenous technique is always there, meditation, which is a mental exercise designed to focus attention and interrupt your flow of other thoughts, worries, and analysis. Let me tell you, if you try to control it, the more you try to control it, it's like a spring. So on the other hand, in meditation, we just let the thoughts loose. Sometimes there is a concentrative meditation as well, where where attention is focused on a single focal point. However, that has to be taught. You have to be taught in, you know, such meditation practices, different schools of meditation though. Then there is what is called receptive meditation, based on widening your attention to become everything experienced at a given point in time. We are talking about mindful meditation nowadays. And then, of course, there may be people who use mantra also. silently during concentrative meditation. Of course, it depends upon your belief system. And then relaxation response occurs at the time of relaxation, usually relaxation either that we give or through your meditation. It's a physiological response which opposes the fight or flight response. So this in brief is, I try to cover as quickly as possible the stress management techniques. And
thank you, ma'am.
Strategies.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, ma'am. Thanks for sharing your valuable information. There are a couple of questions, ma'am.
Mm-hmm.
Just from the participants. So I'll just read out, ma'am. Can I read out? So will the psychological stress leads to suicidal symptoms? That is one question actually raised by one of the participants.
May I address this question first? Does psychological stress lead to suicidal symptoms? Again, like I said in the presentation, it depends upon the personality of the individual. Not everyone who faces stress will feel suicidal. It depends upon the personality of the individual and the interpretation of the individual. Like I said, the term that I have used is cognitive appraisal. If there is a negative cognitive appraisal, if the cognitive appraisal is very negative, and if the person has this ideation, then immediate professional help is needed. But not all people who face stress will actually feel suicidal. This is where several aspects come into picture. One, on from the person's side, positive reappraisal of the situation, replacing the negative self-statements with positive self-statements, looking at the solution as something which can be dealt with and not something which is beyond the solution. So more solution-oriented strategies, taking social support and sharing with near and dear, so that stress can be handled. When, like I said in one of the slides, when there is a share and care, isn't it? So that is one way of dealing with it. Not every person who is stressed up will feel suicidal. There are a few. But if they are feeling suicidal, we have to look into the individual cases as to why they are feeling suicidal. Probably we'll have to deal with it at an individual level. Yes, sir.
Just last question, ma'am. Are rapid mood swing, especially in women, is normal or it's a symptom of stress? As it happens due to some hormonal imbalance. So one of the participants is asking.
Yeah, mood swings in a woman, if you are talking about any one specific case, then it depends again. Let's not generalize and label all women as having mood swings. That's not true. That's not true. Let's not label women as having mood swings. But if any one particular woman has mood swings, then it depends upon several factors. One is, of course, physiological, like hormonal changes or the physiological aspects of her functioning, including the menopausal or onset of menstrual stream or whatever. There are several reasons. Then second can be the context, the circumstances. Third is, of course, the personality of the individual. So I would put it as physical, biopsychosocial. Biological factors may be there, psychological factors may be there, social factors may be there. So when we say mood swings, all these have to be taken into cognizance, and a holistic approach has to be followed in order to help the individual.
So just one, I'm just a little bit curious to know about one small thing from my side, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Is there any study which has been performed? What type of fruits or what type of flowers? Definitely. Fruits in the sense when you consume, you'll be less stressed, or when you smell a flower, it will be less stressed. Something like that. Is there anything, ma'am?
There may be certain studies. I mean, if that's nutrition based, though the area is different, not exactly mine. Nevertheless, let me tell you one thing. What may be a stress relief fruit to someone may not be interpreted the same way by someone else, isn't it? They may not like that fruit. They may not enjoy that fruit. It depends upon, so that is where my psychological interpretation comes into picture, your cognitive appraisal. A fruit as being, stress relief, or a flower, the fragrance being stress relief. For some people, some agarbattis, for example, the fragrance is, it's fragrance for someone. For someone, it is a headache. So it is differentially interpreted. Yeah. Individual differences matter. So is there something? There may be something. Some music may be stress relief for some people. For some people, slow music is stress relief. For some people, slow music is like, you know, saddening. It depends upon our appraisal. So yes, it is individually determined.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your sharing your knowledge, and it's a very interesting session actually. So so far there are no questions, ma'am, from the, so we will wind up the session. Yes. Thanks a lot, ma'am. Srinivasan?
Yes, sir.
Can you please proceed with that polling?
Yes, sir. Sure.
Complete the session.
Sure, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I leave?
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
I request the participants to give their feedback. Poll is started.
Thank you one and all for attending this session. So afternoon, after the post lunch, we'll have the session number 9. Basically, we focus on the Arduino. So this is a programming practice session. So there is no slide presentation and all. So I hope all the participants have received the software link which I have sent in the morning, today early morning. Please be ready with your systems, or if you can understand from the demos, it is fine. We'll meet at 2:30 p.m., please. Thank you.